Daniel Dubois. I think what maybe the right thing to say is Fabio's earned himself a place in the top 15, but that doesn't mean he's going to get the fight next.
No, he won't get the fight next. I mean, we never even discussed that. I mean, Fabio would like it, I'm sure. But, you know, we're in discussion with a couple of people. And Fabio needs to, you know, he needs to fight somebody in the top 10 now and do what he's capable of doing and showing the world what he's all about. But we can build that into being a mega, mega fight that would fill the likes of Wembley out there with two big punches like that.
Yeah. Well, and you're a master also taking like a long-term view. So like, yeah, it probably would be a good fight even if you did it in February, but it would be bigger and better with a bit of building.
It would. It would. And that's what we've got to work towards. In the meantime, Daniel, we're quite near to, I believe, announcing something in the next week or so, and that will be a big fight for him next February.
Brilliant. I mean, can I maybe shouldn't speculate on names, but a name that pops into mind because he's beaten Zhang Zilei and Deontay Wilder is kind of the in-form challenger is Joseph Parker. Like, what is he kind of in the running? Is he a candidate to be considered?
Well, I mean, look, at the moment, as I said, we've got a couple of guys there we're talking to. You know, that would be a good fight, by the way. I haven't got a problem with that fight, but we've got to see what happens and let's see how the dust settles. It's only going to take a week or so to get this over the line. You know, we've been waiting and we had waited to give AJ his opportunity because he said he wanted a rematch, but that's not transpired. It's not working out. So we are where we are.
Yeah. Do you think AJ will want that rematch one day, or do you think he'd be better advised to maybe wait in the wings for a Tyson Fury fight or something like that rather than going through that again with Daniel?
I can't see anything different turning out next time being any different, to be quite honest. How I see the fight, I think he's got his number. I felt very strongly when we made the fight, it was the perfect fight for Daniel, and that's how it turned out to be. And he'll feel even better going into the second fight after such a, you know, a one-sided fight as it was.
Yeah. Because, yeah, so, if you were promoting AJ, I guess it's a big money fight, but also there might be more sensible options out there for him.
I don't know what his options are because, you know, at the end of the day, well, they'll decide that between him and his team. But, you know, the objective for any heavyweight is to fight for the world title. And I suppose maybe they wait to see what happens with Tyson and with him and with the rematch with Usyk. But you know, he's got to establish some credibility, AJ, that's for sure.
And there's no guarantee that AJ can walk straight into a fight with Tyson Fury, because if Tyson beats Usyk and then you got Daniel as a rival world champion, another huge undisputed fight, presumably that would be the big fight to make.
Well, I mean, I can see that, but, you know, all the governing bodies and the way they operate and with their regulations, you can't go in fighting for a world title coming off a comprehensive beating.
Yeah.
He'd have to at least get a win. And that'd be for Tyson coming through to have a voluntary defence.
Yeah. Yeah. And with Daniel in the IBF, he doesn't necessarily, I know they've ordered a final eliminator, but that doesn't necessarily have to, he doesn't necessarily have to get bogged down with the winner of that, because presumably unification would override his mandatory defense.
That is in their rules. So we'll see what happens. But the main thing is for him, his next fight will be a voluntary defense of his title.
Yeah.
The fight against AJ was a mandatory.
Right, yeah. Yeah. So Daniel is in a great position, isn't he?
He is in a great position, and he worked very hard, and he kept the faith and re-established himself. I mean, in the course of 13 months, what he did fighting Usyk, and in that fight with Usyk, he, you know, well, I don't go over the old ground of all that. You know, for me, there was a lot of problems. He felt he was fighting two people with a referee, but, you know, he showed what he's about as far as power's concerned, and I think that fight actually, in the way it turned out, was a blessing in disguise because, you know, we sat down, we all spoke afterwards, and it was like, listen, yeah, it's no good looking the referee and so forth. They're your referees. You go out and you do it yourself, and you're in the other guy's backyard. You've got to go and kick ass, and you've got to win fights and do it the hard way. And coming back as he did with that fight against Babe Miller, which was a very competitive fight, and it was a tough fight for him, for a guy who certainly was looking to psych him out mentally with, you know, before the fight and during the fight, you know, keep giving him You know, thinking there was a weakness there, and he overcome that and certainly showed he's dangerous all the way through a fight, and certainly up until the last round, as that's when he stops Miller. And then the next one was a fight against a guy who's undefeated. Nobody wanted to fight. Had been a mandatory challenger in Hergovic, was mandatory challenger for what, 2 years, much avoided fighter, undefeated, good amateur pedigree. And the first couple of rounds of that were tough for him. He was getting caught with some serious big right handers, and he took them. And then, you know, then the fight became his. When he got into it, he started using that superb jab. He's got to keep banging on to him and other fighters. It's the jab. It's all about the jab. That's what boxing's about. You know, go and look at the great fighters. They all had fabulous jabs. They were all great jabbers. And if you want to be a heavyweight, just go and study, you know, just go and study Larry Holmes, best jab in the business, or even Ali, you know, when he was younger. But Larry Holmes, to me, was like, his jab was superb. And that's what he done. He started working really, really hard on his jab. He's had a new trainer now. Him and Don have really gelled, put his dad in his corner. There was lots of facets and things that we had to do, but it's all worked for him. And he's now only, I'm gonna say, 27 years of age, and he's a young 27, if you know what I mean. And he's sudden, and also he's matured mentally, which was the most important thing for him. He's matured mentally and in a good place. And that job he did against AJ, as I said earlier on, was comprehensive. I mean, he'd done a job on him from the first round. And like I said before the fight, whoever establishes himself with that jab and puts the other guy on the back foot will win that fight. And he did that in the first round.
Yeah. I mean, he's a great success story in British boxing, because it would have been easy after the Joe Joyce defeat to say, all right, that's his ceiling. Easy after the Usyk loss to say that's his ceiling.
People were saying that, weren't they? Yeah. People were saying that, Joe. I mean, you know, people in the trade. I mean, you know, when I think of people like Tony Bellew, he will be get taken away in an ambulance after this fight. I mean, what a thing for a professional boxer or an ex-professional boxer to even say in talking about a fight, you know, say, right, I fancy the other guy to win, he'll beat, but he'll get taken away in an ambulance. That's a nice thing to say. And thankfully, you know, like you said, you know, the win from him for Daniel was brilliant and showed all his character and whatever. But personal thing for me, people like him, like to come out of what he came out with and to be, you know, to at the end of the day, to be, you know, shown that, you know, what happened in the past was as what we said had happened. He did get a serious eye injury and so forth, but he persevered and stuck to his task and done what a lot of people didn't think he could. Every one of these fights we've just discussed, each one of them, he went in as an underdog, not favourite in any one of those fights.
Yeah, interesting. Yeah, that's really interesting. But that's not going to be the case anymore. He's proven himself, hasn't he?
Look, I've got to tell you something. You know, that fight on the 21st in Riyadh season, fight on the 21st, that unification fight is, sorry, not unification, that fight with the rematch is going to be something extra, extra special. And with the outcome, that's going to be interesting to see where we go with Daniel and Harry. You know, he's got, I genuinely do believe that Tyson will win the fight. So you may down the road see an all-British, yet another all-British world title fight would be absolutely astounding. But what a great rematch as well. Win or lose with Usyk. Yeah. What a great rematch. And I'd love to see that to put the record straight.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and there's a great story to that rematch, yeah. But also, yeah. Presumably Daniel's going to be even more, well, he's going to be much more confident now, especially after the Joshua win.
Yeah, I mean, you know, and that's the thing with him. I think it's just, I think this, you see the attitude to him, John, in the build-up to fights, you know, the round table, whereas normally, I mean, he doesn't like doing press. He doesn't want to talk to the media. He's got no interest in that. All he does his fight, and then he goes home. That's all he's interested in doing. And if you look at those last few fights, certainly when we've done those round tables, he got right into it, and he weren't going to be intimidated by anybody, and they weren't set ups or anything. They were generally, you've been to those things, you was there, I think, weren't you?
Yeah.
What happened. I mean, it's generally what happened, and he stood his ground. Not only stand his ground, I mean, he was willing to have it there and then.
Yeah, no, it's brilliant. So do you think he'll be ringside for the Fury-Usyk rematch, sort of scouting both guys?
Absolutely, he should be there for it, shouldn't he? I mean, he's got a quarter of all the belts.
Yeah, and he could fight both Tyson and Usyk, over the course of 2025, 2026?
Yeah, I mean, there's a raft of fights there for him. You know, you got the Zhang fight, as you mentioned earlier, Parker. There's loads of different fights. A big fight can be built up between him down the road with Fabio. I mean, could you imagine two big bangers like that in the ring? That's
Yeah.
not a hard fight to sell, is it?
Yeah.
I mean, it's going to be that's going to be a shootout. That's
Yeah.
what it'll be.
Yeah. I mean, Fabio, just with that performance against Frazier, we couldn't really like celebrate it that much at the time because we were worried about
Yeah,
Frazier's condition.
sure.
But now
Yeah.
Frazier's all right. It's worth sort of emphasizing what a brilliant finish from Fabio Wardy that was.
Well, it was unbelievable. I mean, and also the shots he let go before he knocked him over. I mean, those body shots. I mean, he threw a variety of shots, you know, up and down shots, and picked his punches. But the power that he's got is phenomenal. And it was only, I mean, his arm, if Frazier's arm hadn't been over the ropes, he'd have been out on the floor.
Yeah,
Just like he was knocked out, just hanging on the ropes.
yeah. So next for Fabio is to establish himself at that world
Yeah,
level.
get somewhere, you know, one of the guys out of the top 10. He's ranked, I think, number 9 in one of the governing bodies now. So to really establish yourself in that top 10, there's some good fights there, some great matches to be made for next year for him. You know, and he's a really nice guy, and talks really well. He's quite articulate, and I think he's great for British boxing.
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah, you mentioned Parker and Zhang. One of them could get in with Dubois, one of them could get in with Fabio.
There's some good fights there to be done.
I was wondering, like, Parker's not in the IBF top 15, but is that because he's got a WBO interim belt so he doesn't get
I think
ranked?
that's
But
what it is.
he could, if he's still an option for Daniel, because what, that's like
Yeah, I
unification.
think you know, at the moment, the fact that he can have a voluntary, I mean, you know, it's pretty up as long. I mean, you know, we've been it's got to be sensible. I mean, and certainly the criteria for him fighting Daniel. I mean, he fits the criteria for where he's at. I mean, he's re-established himself after Joe Joyce in a big way.
When you mentioned Joe, what's the sort of, is there a route back for him? I know he's at quite an advanced stage of his career. What are you
But he,
thinking?
look, you just said something there. He wants to fight for a world title. As simple as that. So, you know, let's see how we go with it.
And just quickly, I know I've taken up lots of your time,
Don't
but
worry, I'm all right, don't worry.
well, I just wanted to ask about Liam Davis. What are you hoping to see from him this weekend?
Well, he's got a tough match, you know. Masood coming off a really good win. I mean, you know, when Liam got injured, he took advantage of that, and he had a bit of a stoppage he had. What surprised me, I mean, I was unaware at the time, the history between them going back to the amateurs, you know, and the fact that he'd beaten Liam twice as an amateur. So there's no love lost there then. Between them, that's for sure. And but I think it's gonna be a good quality fight. But Liam, he's another guy. He needs to get the plaudits for what he's done. He's won all those belts. That IBO belt was against an extremely good opponent who he'd done a job on. And you think it was only because Inouye's got the four belts, otherwise he'd hold one of those belts now. There's no doubt about it in my mind. He's a world-class fighter, but this is a tough fight for him and one that he's got to come through. But he's a confident guy. And again, as a weight division, we're blessed. We've got some really good fighters there. There's the obviously big fight down the road with Dennis McCann for the winner of the fight. You know, or him and Liam and Dennis would be a huge fight down the road, no doubt about it.
Absolutely. I mean, I was going to ask, is Liam or Dennis fighting Inoue actually not unrealistic? Because it looks like, you know,
No,
Inoue's
it's
fighting is
not.
mandatory. It looks like he might stay at the weight.
Yeah, well, he said he's going to have a couple and then move up, but whatever he does, and that's certainly not. One thing for sure, there's no way Liam would shy away from that.
So he could be looking to like state his credentials, you know, to
Yeah.
get a shot at Inoue.
And you can throw Nick Ball in there as well.
Oh,
I don't like that. I mean, but you know, Nick, look what he's done in the last. In the last, it was within the course of 7 months, the three opponents that he fought, the opponents that Daniels fought in 13 months, the four fights he had. I can't think of any fighters in the world who fought at that level. Those many fights. You know, I mean, not one fight a year or twice a year, but in such a short space of time to have the fights that they've had.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, because activity is so important, isn't it? Especially competition at
Awesome,
high
yeah.
level.
Yeah. And they're quality fighters.
Wow. And with Chantel Cameron, what do you you know, if all goes well for her on Saturday, do you think what the Taylor Serrano winner is plausible?
It's for the interim. It's for the interim title, so to get ordered.
Yeah, yeah. So is that
so
her path?
That's one of the paths. And but I'm a big believer. You know, whatever's there at the time, because boxing changes so dramatically, so quickly with results and so forth, that you take advantage of what you know at that moment in time. But the her path that we're working on at the moment is to go for the full title, obviously.
Right, and yet, well, presumably she's good enough that if an opportunity came up for a big fight up at welterweight, she could jump up and fight a Michaela Mayer or a Tash Jones.
I believe she could do that, and if she wanted to do it, obviously we'd back her.
Yeah. Well, look, I could talk to you for ages, Frank, because it's exciting times. There's loads going on.
It's just marvellous. I mean, it is excitement, and it is such a good time for world boxing, and certainly for British boxing. I mean, we're flying over here, aren't we? We've got such a good scene, and
yeah.
It's just marvellous, and we're just all going from strength to strength.
Yeah, actually, one quick question about Moses Itaoma, because I don't think I spoke to him about him before, but obviously great fight against McKean, but it's not going to be long before he's knocking at the door for, you know, with those top guys.
Well, that's absolutely right. You know, Dempsey, you look at his record, he's only got one defeat, and that was the 12th round of the fight against, at the time, the guy nobody wanted to fight.
Yeah.
In Hergovich, and that was I think that was for the interim title. So that was the level that was at. So this is a big step up for him, and with a guy who's, you know, a man. He's matured. He's been around the block. He's got a winning mentality, and he's certainly willing to step up as he did against Hergovich. And you know, for a teenager, because that's what he still is, Moses. He's a teenager. This is a tough assignment. But he's up for it. We believe in it. You know, he's got a good team around him. My son Francis manages him. You know, Ben Davison's training him. Everybody around him, you know, we all believe in him. And more importantly, he believes in himself and has been delivering.
I mean, at the back of your mind, do you think he might look dazzling against McKean? Like, there is that possibility he could really do a number on him, even though it's a hard fight on paper.
It is a hard fight on paper, and I hope that will be the case. Fingers crossed with that. But, you know, his last fight against... Well, you know, I thought we'd get some rounds out of that, and that was the objective. But the way he went about that fight, the maturity that he showed, again, working behind a superb jab, he opened him up, he picked his shots, and, you know, and getting that jab, you see a lot of, especially young guys, when they got someone in trouble, they sometimes fall onto them because they rush in and they don't get their distance. He measured everything. He measured everything off the jab before he let his shots go. But no, it was punch-perfect performance, a very mature performance. That's why we've stepped him up for this fight.